The next speaker is Amos Salamon from the Geological Service of Israel, and he will be speaking about Inspired by Tsunami, computer simulations of potential scenarios related to the Exodus narrative for all of us who did not get enough of catastrophes. There's another one.
Good afternoon. Okay, it works. Well, several months ago, Tom Levi sent me an email and asking whether I have any idea to put kind of a GIS or 3D idea to put in the exhibition. And I said maybe earthquakes or tsunamis, but for tsunamis you should approach Steve Ward because he's the magician in this field. So we combined together, and then we got some more help from Floyd McCoy about the process of the eruption of the Terra, and started working. So we tried to see what is described there in the text, and the first stage was to see whether there is a specific event described in the story of the Exodus. Or there might be some several other natural effects that we should consider. And we had some geophysical and geological knowledge how to approach the event or interpret the natural effects that we see there. So overall, we tried to play with the ideas more than to solve the exact problem. And we try several things. I think overall we can learn something out of it. I will start talking about the reliability of historical tsunamis because it brings us back to the reliability of the Exodus story. Then show a map about historical tsunamis in the Levant. What do we know about them? Then bring several examples that might resemble or have similar motifs with the story of the Exodus. Then resort to alternative scenarios that might be embedded within the Exodus story. And then wind out with the earthquake. Probably, yeah, with the ultimate candidate for this story. Okay, let's see if we can do that. I won't say much about tsunamis. I think we most know or have the impression that we know what it is, but only that for modern investigation on tsunamis, we would like to describe it, to measure it with a given or certain parameters, and then try to do model and compare the model with the results of the model with our observation. If it goes together within a given uncertainty range, then it is okay. Otherwise, it doesn't work. However, when we try to deal with historical tsunamis, then we have no parameters. We cannot describe it, something that remained at the best in the memory of the people. And we had the stories left behind, and we are trying to get out of the story the real event. So if you go back, for example, to the 9th of July, 551, an earthquake and a tsunami in Beirut, it tells us that the sea, as the sea was rising up against them from behind, the earthquake brought down the city in front of them. This is a report that is accurate in time, in place, and it shows a close association in time and in place between the tsunami and the earthquake. So we believe it is a reliable report, and we can consider it, I would say, like a line in a catalog. This is okay for us. Another example, the 1033 in Palestine, people could gather fish from the sea, from the seabed, found object, etc. The sea withdrew back in this event. This is also associated with an earthquake. And we know also from our experience, from reports from other places in the world, that this is a common phenomena in certain tsunamis. The drawback of the sea, and we will get back to it later on. So again, this is another row, another line in our catalog. On the other hand, we have the problematic events. For example, here is the catalog given by Ambraces from 1962. And he actually gathered all events that he was aware of them and listed them. Now, at the beginning of the list, he said that when he put an asterisk near the number, which is the year, it is a doubtful event. And he ordered the event according to the time. So we can see here that 1811 is coming after 1859. We know from other places in the literature that he actually means 881. So this is a doubtful tsunami with a typo. Now we go later on 32 years to the catalog of David Amiran, which is considered the best catalog we have so far. And at the end of the publication, there is a list of tsunamis. And we look at the list in here, for example, and we see that 811 and 881 appear, both of them appear like regular tsunamis. And this is a mistake. They all probably relate to the 1303 earthquake, which was more or less the simulation Steve Ward showed us before. So in this case, we have one true event and two problematic events. Uranus in this case. And actually half of the list, half of the tsunamis that Amiran listed, we think we did an extensive work on it, are not reliable. Why is that important? After searching and screening the literature, we found out that out of about 60 entries in the literature, only about one third is reliable and two thirds are doubted. This is important for hazard evaluation, and this is also important while going back to examine the Exodus story. In this case, at least in my view, we do not have a good coordinate in time and place for the event of the Exodus. So we cannot put it in the frame or in the frame of modern perspective of science. Maybe the solution would be to reconstruct the time frame of the narrator. What does it mean, the time and place that he meant for, or that it was not a real event? But in any case, for us, it is considered a not a reliable event. We cannot put it as a line in our catalog. But still, there is a description of a natural effect in it, so I think it is okay to try to examine what are the effects that the writer are talking about. So overall, of the reliable events, we have a map of tsunamis that affected the Levantine coast in here. We got the earthquake. For each of the event, we have the focus of the earthquake, which in our case, most of them are on land and the tsunamis are in the sea. This is a really weird mechanism. It was another talk, but this is what happens in our case. And I will get to some examples from this map later on. And complementary to this map, we have tsunamis that arrived from far away. This is a perspective of the eastern Mediterranean basin. We got events coming as far as from the Messina Straits, but most of them are coming from Crete and the Hellenic Arc. This is important also for us from a perspective of warning. This kind of event let us about 2 or 3 hours warning time, comparing to the other events, the close events that allows us only a few minutes of warning time. In any case, there is a nice example of the earthquake in 1956 in the Aegean Sea, very close to the Terra event, of which we have a record in the Jaffa port. So earthquake was in the morning in the Aegean Sea. This is the mareogram, is the registration of the sea level. We can see the tide, and superimposed of it are the regular waves. Amplitude by centimeters, time from left to right. The earthquake is about 6 o'clock in the morning. Now we are waiting until it arrives to Jaffa. This is the next day, and we can very easily see that the pattern of the waves, the tide remains the same, but the pattern of the waves is completely different. Like in like in the Murphy law, the exact time when the wave arrived to Jaffa, the man came to work and just replaced the paper in the machine. So we lost the first minute of this event. Anyway, it was as high as 28 centimeters, hardly felt by people, but it shows for us that a tsunami can arrive from the Aegean Sea to the Levantine coast, to Jaffa in this case. Now, if you want to go back to the 17th or 16th century BC, to the Terra event, we think it is plausible that such an event would arrive to the Levantine coast, except that the timing is a problem. We need to have the exodus to happen in this time window, and otherwise, then we need another tsunamigenic sources if we think a tsunami affected this place. So let's see in our archive whether we have some motifs in time, space, and description that may be connected or associated with the exodus story. Before that, we need to realize that the shape of the land or the geography was a little bit different, especially for the tsunami matters. And we reconstructed the shape of the Nile according to the work of Stanley in this area. He shows that about 4,000 years ago, the coastline was a little bit inland comparing to that of today. And I'll take this opportunity to thank Jessica, Steve, and Philip for reconstructing the bathymetry and the geography of this area in order to simulate tsunamis according to what was the what were the conditions at that time. Okay, so let's start. The first one, evidence we have from Ugarit. It's maybe the right time, I don't know, more or less, but it is far away, maybe too far away. And the story is that the half of the town was flooded, probably by seawater. What is interesting in here, that the evidence is coming from the Amarna letters, still in Egypt, so they might have knew about this event. And what allows us also to think that this is a reliable report is that the clay seems to come from Syria. I think this is Goren et al., maybe together with you. Yeah. So I think it is quite a strong evidence for the reliability of this event. Next would be the 20 BC event. This is near in place. This is very near to the, actually along the Nile Delta, but far in time, at least one millennium difference. The sea about Pelusium and Mount Cassius rose and flooded the country and made an island out of the mountain so that the road by Mount Cassius into Phoenice became navigable. In this case, Paro should have used boats instead of chariots. Anyway, that's the place. And we take a close look in this area. If you consider the present geography, then the vulnerable or the exposed part of the northern route is quite small. But if we take into consideration the correct geography, then there is quite a considerable segment that might be affected by such an event. Okay. We have no sign of earthquake regarding this event, so we think that this might be caused by a landslide in the Nile. This is another simulation that Steve showed us. If we have look at the bathymetry of the Nile cone in this area by recent work by Garzilia et al., then we see a huge scar, and whether it is released by an earthquake or spontaneously, then it should have generated a very large tsunami. So we are okay with that mechanism and principle. Similar description, let's see this event, second century BC, wave from the ocean lifted itself to extraordinary height and dashed upon the shore, engulfing all men and drowning them. We miss the chariots, but it seems more or less like, in essence, like the story of Exodus. So the description here is more or less similar. Okay, so overall we have some several motifs that seems okay for the Exodus scenario, but is it okay? Can we say that it's a tsunami inspired the story somehow? Well, I don't think so, because if we read what is written there, there are some more ingredients, some more motifs that we need to consider. For example, we can talk about the Habub. So basically, instead of talking about tsunamis, I can start all over again and talk about the Habub. That's a Habub. If we read the text in Exodus 14:20, then it was a cloud and darkness to them, so that the one came not near the other all the night. If you're outside, you're fine, but if you're inside this cloud of dust, then you can't see. It is dusty and very windy. This is actually the front of a storm that is looking like a wall of dust. It is common in a desert area. This actually is taken from Arizona, not far away from here, but this is from Egypt. So dust storms are very common in there. And if we take this satellite photograph, then we see really a huge dust storm covering the whole area. And in many times, this type of storms bring a heavy rain or heavy flood after that. And this was the reason for simulating the flood in the Sinai, like what Steve showed us before. Water accumulated within the basin of the El Arish River and draining into the Mediterranean. I think we are talking about a real thing. 1975, there was a real flood in this area. This work by Micha Klein from Haifa University. And this small delta was formed within a night or within one instance of a flood. The big wall that we saw in the exhibition actually showed several examples of of the simulations we have, just to show the what we are able to do. The matter or the problem is that if we would like to make a realistic simulation, we would like to have the exact or more or less reliable parameters. Otherwise, it is garbage in, garbage out. So tracing or trying to reconstruct the exact parameters is there is some work to do in it. Okay, so if I go back to what Steve summarized, then the generalized problem is try to move water from one place to another, and we have these several tools or several mechanisms, or move the land, and we have several more mechanisms. So now that we got the idea and we have a kit of tools, a kit of earth science tools, we can try to examine any kind of narrative. Let's take the Exodus, for example. So we can start all over again the talk, this time about earthquakes. But let's make a short twist in here. This time I would like to refer to Tehilim Kuf Yud Aleph, Psalms 114, Betzet Israel Mimitzrayim. When Israel went out of Egypt, when the sea saw it and fled, I was talking about it. I showed the example of 1033. Jordan was driven back. We know, and here is a photograph from the 1927 earthquake in Jericho. There is a collapse of the bank nearby the Jordan. Jordan is behind behind the trees. And we have some other events that tell about the stop of the flow of the Jordan River for several hours or several days. Next is the mountains skipped like rams, etc. There is another example from Mount of Olives in Jerusalem, 1927 earthquakes. And we can see that the damage because of the earthquake was more intense on the mountain area. There's also some observations about amplification of the shaking on mountains. So it is more or less reasonable. And this is all because of the earthquake. This would be an invited question later on. What about the water? Okay, so what I can say overall is that I have the feeling that the ancient people were used, if not sometimes abused, natural effects for their own narratives. It is very trivial, I think, conclusion, but it worth thinking because nature, the way we see it, is not like the nature they saw it, and the effects are not shown in details or exactly as we see it today. There are some modifications in it. But in general, this is I think, what we see in here. I think as Earth science representative, we can offer some tools how to try, how may help decipher, not decipher, may help decipher such problems. And specifically for the Exodus, I think we can try to decode the source of inspiration. But we are not in a stage that we can tell what really did happen there. Thank you very much.
Okay. Yes, Gary.
Hello? Okay.
Good.
Gary Rensberg. Only because you invited the question, ha hofchi hatsor la'aga mayim. Please comment.
Okay. Thank you for your question. Well, this might be too far away, but after there was a 7.2 magnitude earthquake in Nueva, along the Gulf of Eilat, about 17 years ago. And one of the observations were that there was a change in the rate of flow of springs along the Arava Valley. And these springs are very close or along rock formations, which are made mainly of chert or flint. So I would relate this to a kind of, and there are many other hydrological effects that are associated with earthquake. We can see the change of flow, whether increase or decrease. We can see some dust in the water, change in the chemistry, and so on. But so it might be. Overall, what I think about this, in my eyes, this could be a coherent description of a single earthquake, which is typical to Israel, because they talk about the Jordan, they talk about the receding of the sea because of a tsunami, and a setting of Israel is good for that. So in here, whether it is really related or not, this is a later text, as far as I understand, comparing to the Exodus story, but it is related to the exit from Egypt. So in this case, they borrowed an earthquake for the description. Whether the specific event was during an earthquake, I don't know.
Yes, Brad.
Brad Sparks. Can you tell us a little bit about the phases of the Theron eruption, and allow me to ask you a question about that. Am I right that there were two or three phases of ash deposition and possible gigantic tsunamis, so that we have different phases of ash, tsunami, ash, and maybe some more tsunamis, right? Something like that?
Something like that. It starts with probably with earthquakes that express the rise of the magma from below. Mm-hmm. And maybe this is the warning sign for the citizens of Akrotiri to run away. Then there is a start of explosions and flow of lava, which by itself can generate tsunamis. Mm-hmm. Then there might be a stage that seawater are getting inside and interacting with the lava, and you start to get explosions. And this stage is also can also generate tsunamis. And the final stage is considered to be the formation of the caldera, the collapse after all the ash and the lava is out. Everything collapsed inside, and this might be another generator. So, as far as I understand, the event is not a single event. It's a group of events, and we can have several mechanisms for tsunamis. That is the explosion, a pyroclastic flow into the water, caldera collapse, and the collapse of the banks of the volcano, if there was a volcano at the time, And each of them could generate a tsunami. So actually, there were maybe dozens of tsunamis, not yes. a single one.
So
as long as we don't know the exact parameters or the size of what have happened there, we cannot say which was, if at all, the tsunami. But there were many.
But I've seen estimates of hundreds of feet for the height of the tsunami at one phase.
Could you say it again, please?
100-meter-size tsunamis within...
Could be. Well, it depends on the on the size of the triggering mechanism. And sure. This would be very close to the origin place. But as you go further away, the waves attenuate and decrease.
Sure.